If you haven't taken in the messages, Jeff does have the sheets that he can send them to you, or how can they get them?
I just attach it to the link to the video each week.
You link it to the video?
Yeah, there's a PDF attachment.
There's a PDF attachment right to the video.
Yeah.
So you can
email.
Go right online.
No, just from your email. And then it's attached in the embedded email, yeah.
Attached in the email. And then it'll take you to YouTube.
My links, yeah.
By the link, it'll take you to YouTube. And then you can get the message there. And you got the attachment for the other message. Demonstrated his own love for us in this way, that while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. He loves us. Not because we've turned to him. He loved us when we didn't give a rip or a thought about it. He's reaching and he's there. That's our God. Just talk. Open the door. I remember an individual some years ago talked to me about how they had just recently come to Christ. They were still smoking. As they were smoking, they were saying, "Jesus, I don't know what to do with this issue. I know this isn't really in your great plan for me to do this." Just talking to Jesus wherever you are about anything, letting him in, just letting. How the Lord began talking to them right there. Can you imagine? God begins to talk to you in the place that you've maybe locked him out. That you're really not thinking about him, or you really have never really thought about him during those moments. It will forever change. It's going to change what you do, how you think, because this is the place where I meet God. And God's right here. And start talking to him about it all. How it forever changed to them, and how that just fell away. when certain things meet, when they have that look. You know, it is just funny. There's this aspect that Jesus wants us to bring us in on the inner circle. He wants to share his life with us. The secrets of his life. It's just like, wow. It reminds me of the passage, I think it's in Psalms, where it talks about how God shared his law with the people, but his ways with Moses. Because Moses talked with God as a friend would talk to another friend. Remember that? In the tent. They talked as friends. A.W. Tozer says, what comes into your mind when you think about God is the most important thing about you. It's a rather profound story. What comes into your mind, think about it. If God is, and I think we all know, is to be the center of our lives. So how we think about him is huge. There are various ways that we think about God.
So you have to keep by an ink.
Exactly.
It's the way we're designed.
I know.
So they designed to make you buy an ink.
Not all of them used to be like that. Not all of them used to be like that. What comes into your mind when you think about God is the most important thing about you. What do you think about that? Crouching tiger God. He's just waiting to pounce on you because you're going to do something wrong. There's the flaky father God. He's moody. He changes his mind about you continually. He's flaky. Yeah. Or there's the cosmic cop God. His only purpose is to enforce the rules. He's the big cop in the sky. He's the dictator God, always demanding more and more. Or some people think God is the Santa Claus in the sky, making the list. And if we're nice, we get gifts, but if we're naughty, well, you know, you get that cold. And some of us have the Play-Doh guy. We just want to make him do whatever we want him to do. It says that, you know, we're created in the image of God, but we want to create God in our image.
And you know, some of that Play-Doh, if it's homemade,
how many ever had Mr. Potato Head? You know, and what do you do with Mr. Potato Head?
Put the ears where the legs are.
You can create whatever you want with it. You can do all sorts of stuff with it. And you know, that's what, you know, we have our pet verses. That's how, you know, the certain verses, you know, we always take a black magic marker.
To cross them out or to highlight?
What?
Not cross them out.
You know, a black.
The black.
don't tell me who they are. They just go into whatever. How do you know how to talk to somebody if you don't know who they are? Or what they're about? How do you do that? You know, I'm on my guard. Aren't you? When people start, you know, they start talking.
They don't even take a breath.
And I think some of us, really our concept of God, how do we talk to Him if we don't know who He is? Who is He? Who is God? And there are all sorts of things in the Bible that talk about who our God is. But we really don't know who He is. We begin to realize our God is really all we need. Only until when our God is all we got. You've tried everything else. Sort of like the woman who had the issue of blood. She'd been in doctor's hands for years. She had a problem. She pursued Jesus. She tried everything else. Part of it is encountering Him, opening ourselves up to Him. Talk to Jim a little bit about this. How many of you have had that your experience in God far outweighed your knowledge of God? Most of us, our knowledge about God far outweighs our experience of God. We know about this in the Bible, this in the Bible, this in the Bible, but that's not what we encounter. There is a place when you start to encounter God that it blows your mind. You don't even know what's going on. Sort of what's happening in the Rakish family. Some of the people there,
they didn't know what was going on.
This can't be God. Their experience of what was going on in God in that house blew their minds. It's far beyond their knowledge. And what that does is it makes us uncomfortable because we're definitely not in control. Isn't that right, Jim? The Holy Spirit came on you. You don't know how to respond. You don't know how to act. You're experiencing something. You don't even understand it, but you know it's right. And you're going, and this is a good place. She knows some things about God now in a different way than she knew before. Now she knows, and the word know there really is experientially. We don't need more head knowledge, right? When we say, I want to know you, God, I want to encounter, experience. I want to experience you on the deepest level because we can go. Heard story. It was last night when I was doing the dishes. Benita had Alexa on. She had Alexa on the WCRF, and there's Tony Evans preaching. And he's talking about how he was looking forward to this vacation, and they were going on this cruise. He was going to do some ministry. As soon as he got on that cruise, he had this pain in his mouth. Didn't know exactly what it was. And that every day the pain got worse. Till about day 3 or 4, he went to the doctor that's on board, you know, They got harbors on board. Did you know they have caskets on their ships? Absolutely. Like the QE2, which is a huge ship, they got 15 caskets. You know what? If you ever been on a cruise, it's like a geriatric convention. If you've been on a cruise in February, I'm telling you. And there's a lot of older people, and people die. Wow. You don't think about it, but people die. Well, they had the doctor, and the doctor gave him some opioids of some sort. Supposed to kill the pain. Didn't touch it. Supposed to take it every 4 hours. He said it was supposed to kind of make you loopy, I guess, a little bit. That's what he said. He started taking it more often, but it didn't kill the pain, didn't do anything to the pain. He called his dentist. The dentist said, "You got an infection. You can take all the pain medicine you want to. Things are not going to change until you get to the root of the problem. We come to church, we hear messages. We pray, we do all sorts of stuff. We have not gotten to the root issue. We got to know God from the deepest levels. Experience and encounter Him in the deepest places. We're not going to change. It's just filling. We just get more knowledge to feel more guilty. And know that I'm not following God. We need a revival. Deepest levels. So the doctor phoned it in some. On the ship, they phoned it in some antibiotics. Probably you heard me now. I didn't finish the whole message. I was done. If you haven't heard Tony Evans live. It's a lot different than on that TV, or on the radio. You're only live now. I'll tell this part. God's anointed him.
I like listening to him.
He
gets agitated.
Yeah, he used to give me a headache.
Is that right? Things.
I turn him off because
he's intense.
Yeah. Well, he's intense. It's between the eyes. He's a between the eyes kind of preacher. How's your mind when you think about God's most important thing? When you think about God, it's the most important thing. Because we have a tendency to pray from our heart. We don't have certain places in our heart. It's discomfort. So ask God. Give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation. That He would open the eyes of our heart that we could know Him better. That's where it comes from. Your understanding of who God is. Really, who God is really like shapes everything else in your life, especially how you pray. God's plan for my life will always be good.
Just keep it, Dave.
What I want to talk about today is that we can talk about all sorts of things about God. But the one thing I want to talk about today is that God is a good God. that God is a good God. Let's think about this. If God isn't good, why should we ever pray to Him? Let's just think about it. If God's not good, why should we ever pray? Psalm 105 says, "The Lord is always good." 100 verse 5. The Lord is always good. He is always loving and kind, and His faithfulness goes on to each succeeding generation. The Lord is always good. Say, He's always good.
Always good.
He's always good. Who's always good? Is Sam always good? But Sam's God is always good. Because, number one, someone came to Jesus and said, "You know, good teacher, how can we inherit eternal life?" Well, how did Jesus answer it?
Only God is good.
Only God is good. That is the basis. The goodness of God is the basis, to me, of one of the key elements of prayer. He's good. He's always good. As it says in James, all good things come from above, from the Father of lights. All good things come from above. So if anything that has ever happened in your life that's good, it's from God. Some people don't know who to thank. Smart, or because I did this, or because this happened, or it was fate, or whatever it was.
I was lucky.
They don't know who to thank. All good things. If it was truly good, it was from God. All good things come from above. Here's a question. Is there anything God can't do? Can't fail.
Can't stop loving us.
Can't break His promise.
Can't do it.
Can't look upon sin.
He can't deny His own character. God, it's impossible for God not to be good. How about that? He's always good. Jeremiah, "I know what I plan for you, says the Lord. I have good plans for you." Turn to your neighbor. God's got good plans for you. He's got good plans for you. How do you know that the plans are, they're not done yet? Maybe, He's already completed the plans. I guess I'm in retirement now. How do you know when the plans have been fulfilled and completed?
When He takes you home.
Yes, if you're on the earth, if you're on the earth, His plans are still there. He's got... That means there are things that He's thought out beforehand. This isn't whimsical. He's got plans.
And He's not a short order cook. He's a chef. He's a simmer.
Amen. He's a chef because you go to these restaurants, they have these canned recipes. And some of them are good. But they're canned. All they have to do is follow through. God's the chef. He's cooked up something just for you.
I want to see what the God is cooking.
I have good plans for you, not plans to hurt you. My plans will give you hope and a good future. There's that word again. His business plans will give you hope and a good future. And when you call to me and pray to me, I will listen. You see the connection between prayer and knowing that God is good? There it is. Then you'll call me. If you know I have good plans for you, and you know that I have a good future for you, let's talk. Trust me. There's a way. I have a great plan, a great way for you. You're not an accident. There's a purpose for your life. God put a lot of thought in creating your life. And a lot of those are revealed and realized through prayer. He didn't have to create a plan for us. He could have just said, have at it. Why didn't he do that? Why didn't he just say, here it is, have at it? What do you think?
He does things with design and purpose.
Because he's good. Because he knows. Because it's revealed. How's your life going to turn out?
Bad.
Left to our own devices. We know. We think we have good plans. We think we have good thoughts. We think we have a good way. How many have ever said, choices. We know that God causes everything to be together for good, to the good of those who love God and are called. There's that word again. He will. We know that God causes everything to work together for good. Does not say everything is good. Everything is good. Everything feels good. Everything was good. You know, God can override whatever happened. tried vanilla by itself? It's not good.
Smells great.
You can take every ingredient by itself, but you know what? God is the chef. God's the chef. What's he do? He throws it all together. He turns our bitter into batter so that we become better.